Hello and welcome to my review of Saw 6, which came out in 2009. Saw 6 was the directorial debut of Kevin Grunhardt. Now, a bit of backstory to Kevin Grunhardt and his catches at the Saw universe. If you don't know who he is at this point and you're a Saw fan, then a bit concerning. But Kevin Grunhardt was the man who edited Saws 1 through 5 and directed 6 and 7 and then went on to edit Jigsaw. He was originally going to edit Spiral from the Book of Saw, but due to scheduling conflict, he is now only an executive producer on Spiral from the Book of Saw, and someone called Dev Singh did edit Spiral from the Book of Saw. So yeah, so Saw 6 came out in 2009, and if you ask me, it's a strikes back of the series, because it genuinely is one of the best in the series. I'd have to say it's probably second or third favourite as of now. I haven't seen Spiral yet. It's definitely second or third. That second place is a fight really between Saws 2 and 6 for me personally. So yeah, but again, Saw 6, and it's so good because the story is very good and very engaging with the characters of William Easton. The traps are some of the best the series has seen, and the music is on top form here, especially with Zep 6 being one of the best versions of Zep, Hello Zep, we've ever heard. So it all around makes one of the most enjoyable films of the franchise. If, like I said in the previous ones, you've watched 1 through 3, like I suggested, and you don't like them ones and you jump off, I would suggest at least trying 6 at some point. Don't have to watch the others, it doesn't matter. I wouldn't recommend 5. 5 is terrible, like I mentioned in my review. But I would recommend at least trying 6. You don't have to try 7 or Jigsaw, because they're not exactly the best. But here is an installment in the franchise where it's almost, you know, it was never going to be on the level of the original, because the original was something special. But here we have incredible traps. We have the shotgun carousel, which is my favourite trap of the entire series, personally. We have the breather trap from the beginning. We have the pound of flesh trap from the opening. We have the steam, I'm going to call it a steam room, I haven't got a better name for the steam room, the one which she wants for the room. We have the hang trap, I'm going to call it as well, the one when they hang. So while I do think that the hang trap and the steam trap are fairly weaker traps, I don't think they're anywhere near. I think some of the traps from 5, they're definitely better than most of the traps from 5, but like I said, the pound of flesh trap, while I have something to say about the pound of flesh trap, and I think one of either Caesar's World or Dead Meat mentioned it. I think it was Caesar's World because I watched that video, isn't it? But one of the two mentioned that the pound of flesh trap is immediately unfair against the woman, because obviously Jigsaw's games are usually fair, and you know, fair games that you can easily, ones that are done by John Kramer at least, are usually games that can easily be won. And even though this one was orchestrated by Hoffman, it was obviously, you know, done by, and you know, created by Kramer. But what I'm trying to say is, with the pound of flesh trap, is that you've got this larger man and this quite skinny woman. So by default, if the whole idea of the game was to give away bits of your flesh, by default she has a disadvantage, because she notices it when she goes to open her shirt, the bottom of her shirt, because she sees him getting a knife and stabbing bits of his belly flesh off to put it in, and she goes to do the same thing, opens the bottom of her shirt, because obviously you can't have titties in the movie that much, at least. I mean, Saw 3, there's titties in Saw 3, but yeah, you can't have that. So she lifts it up a little bit, she looks at it and she realises that she's got barely any flesh, because again, it's an unfair trap, because he's got more. Well, she does end up smashing her arm and winning eventually, which is why I'm happy that she wins. I just think that it's just unfair, because he automatically had much more of a chance of winning by default. He had an advantage over her, which is not how these games are supposed to go. But at the end of the day, again, like I said, at the end of the day, the movie's lots of fun. Pound of Flesh Trap is one that is not knowing it my favourite, but I can still enjoy Pound of Flesh when watching it. But again, Shotgun Carousel was the best trap in the series in my mind, bar maybe the Reverse Bear Trap and the Shithole Game. But other than that, I think it's top tier series traps, and I'm hoping the Spiral brings us some more top tier traps as well. I don't know. I mean, the Finger Trap and the Spiral looks good. and the what's the other track we see? Oh yeah, the tongue trap, which we've seen before. That trap, I feel like, I don't know how winnable the other traps are in Spiral, but watching that opening clip, that trap is very winnable from the outset. But anyway, back to Saw 6. Again, story-wise, it's more Hoffman, following Hoffman. And what I like about here is that it's that Erickson, and who reveals that Lindsay Perez from Saw 4 is still alive. But what I find interesting is that it's not made implicit, but if you look at the mannerisms from both Perez and from Erickson at certain parts in the movie, at least in this one, not in 5, they didn't even suspect him in 5, but in here, they're very, just so subtly suspicious of Hoffman in several circumstances, in several places, and they get towards their final scene in the movie before they, spoilers, game end, they are incredibly suspicious of Hoffman, and it's quite obvious, especially Perez, because I think, obviously, what Caesar's Wildy explained this theory that when there's a post-credit scene, one of them, I think it's 4, I don't actually know, but where Amanda goes and tells Jeff's daughter to not trust the person who rescues her, which it's then implied through other events that, or at least from the way Lindsay Perez says things, that what we can only assume is that because she was onto him for a while, we can assume that once Hoffman had saved her and brought her out, and she and the little kid went up to Lindsay Perez and said, oh, this lady, the dead lady, told me not to trust this man, so then she instantly got suspicious of Hoffman. I don't know, that's just this is easy world game theory. But yeah, but yeah, again, it's just, I like the idea of them very subtly showing that the Erickson and the FBI very, very subtly onto Hoffman. And obviously by the end, when Erickson does his little, I like this bit because it's great where he talks, he says all sciencey mumbo jumbo just there about trying to scramble the voice, and Hoffman's looking directly at Erickson, and Erickson goes, oh, we found traces of blah 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 and blah blah blah, and then Hoffman goes, in other words, when Strom put his fingerprints on the latest victim, he was already dead. And then at that exact moment the tape unscrambles, and then they find out that it was Hoffman, and then Hoffman at the end of this film, and then in the next film, just goes absolute sicko mode. And in that scene, he stabs Erickson, throws a cup of boiling coffee over Perez, uses the lady who was unscrambling the tape as a shield. So she dies. He then stabs Lindsay Perez about 12 times in a lower abdomen. He then leaves, gets Strom's hand out of the car. Goes back in, puts the fingerprints all over it, sees that Erickson is still alive, pours gasoline over Erickson, and then sets fire to the building. That's nothing compared to what he does in Saw 7, where he basically goes and destroys and kills half a fucking police station. But we'll get to that in a couple of days' time, being that day, probably being Saturday, as Thursday I have a screening of Mortal Kombat. My return to the cinema was supposed to be fucking Spiral from the Book of fucking Saw, but fucking Odin isn't fucking showing it. But yeah, again, Saw 6 is just one of the best installments. It's right up there. It's definitely a strides back in the series. Like I said, the Shotgun Carousel is absolutely fucking brilliant. But it was unfortunate in that, while the film itself was really well made, really well directed, edited, shot, scored, its box office failings drastically changed what would happen with the next installment in the franchise. We'll talk about that when we get to it. I've been reading the Wikipedia article for that film. And also, that's the only film I have on singular Blu-ray. I have it on Blu-ray twice. See, this is Blu-ray. I have it in the Saw Legacy Collection, the Blu-ray, and then I also got a singular version of the Blu-ray because I was surfing at a shop called Pound Shop and they had it. So I picked it up because, you know, that was before I bought the original Blu-ray that I have. But yeah. Again, it's just, I feel, I like William Easton's trial in this film is brilliant. I like the subtle reveals that we're supposed to believe that the man, that the Devon Bostick, who, if you don't know who Devon Bostick is, he played Roderick in the Diary of a Wimpy Kid movies, but he's in this movie, that him and his mum are the wife and son of William Easton. But when we get to that end scene, it's revealed that in actual fact, family that Jigsaw was talking about was actually Pamela Jenkins, who was his sister. And I love that twist. That it's almost essentially a twist. It is, but at the same time, I think that ending scene not only just really makes me think of one of the most brutal and gruesome deaths in the entire series, but which is quite painful to watch. If you don't know, it's not really a spoiler, but what happens is he gets stabbed with a bunch of needles containing hydrofluoric acid, and the hydrofluoric acid then burns his insides completely to the point where all his organs are out, and the lower part of his body just falls off completely. It's absolutely graphic and gruesome. And you can always argue that it's not a deserved death. I always think about this scene, and then this scene where Daniel Wigg has 2 seconds left on the fucking clock, and he breaks into the door, killing Detective Eric Matthews. So there's that. I always think of these two scenes, and that every time I watch them, you really hope he does the right thing, but obviously, you know he's going to do the wrong thing because you see him do it before. You know what I mean? But again, Saw 6 is just really well done. I think music-wise, absolutely brilliant. Zep 6 is one of the best Zeps we'll be hearing over this video as I'm speaking. So, I mean, that just elevates the movie to a whole other level. It's just one of those sort of movies where, although the previous 5 was most definitely my least favourite of the entire franchise, I just think this one is just structured so much better than 5, than 4 in some regards. But it's good to see. Another big reveal here is that Amanda was present when John and Jill lost their baby, when Jill lost the baby. So, and it was also the note that Hoffman left was changed. He was originally supposed to write a different note that John told him to write, but Hoffman, wanting all the power, wrote a note saying that Hoffman knew that Amanda was there when the night they lost Gideon, and that if Amanda doesn't kill Lynn Denlin, Hoffman will tell John what she did, which is the reason why we see Amanda crying in Saw 3 over the baptism music, and is the reason why she eventually ends up killing Lynn Denlin, and then that results in her own death. But yeah, that's fun. Yeah, Saw 6 is just one of the films where, again, genuinely, I think it's just so well written, and again, lighting-wise and colour scheme-wise, it's one of the films that also has some scenes with this lovely paletted colour, and flashback sequences usually almost have this greyscale effect over it, or some nice bloom, like the scene we see, I think it's towards the beginning of the movie with Amanda and Cecil. It has this almost bloomish effect, but again, Saw's colouring has always been interesting. And it's interesting that this one takes place in a zoological institute. But like I said, I'm really just going to brag about how much this shotgun carousel is essentially Saw's greatest trap other than Reverse Bird Trap. It's so well done. And most of the traps in this movie are really brilliant. And again, Saw 6 is really good. I have to admit, it is one of the best of the series. I can sit down and enjoy this movie after being very disappointed with Saw 5. And I'm just happy that Saw 6 was brilliant. But reading on how director Kevin Grunhardt was treated when it comes to the next movie is very upsetting. But, well, not upsetting, but just disheartening into how these movies are made. But I'll be going into quite intense detail, not as graphically intense detail as this film, but in detail about the beginning of the production of Saw 3D and elements of it. So that's going to be an interesting one. I don't know what I'm going to title that video yet. Saw 7, Saw 3D, Saw the final chapter. Like Assisi World pointed out, there's not really much of a way to watch it in 3D anymore, and it's not the final chapter, so there's no point in calling it either of those, so I might as well call it Saw 7. I don't actually know. We'll just get... I just will get to it when we get to it. But yeah, thank you guys for watching. Have a wonderful day and enjoy. Don't forget to check out my GTA 3 Part 2 Let's Play on my Green Without a Second channel. Bye bye for now.